Let's turn to Psalm 23. I'm going to be reading from the ESV. I'd be delighted for you to read with me, to recite this. We all know it by heart. And why don't we just stand again and let's read the Word of God. So you can read it, recite it, and if you can keep up with me. All right. This is a declaration of faith. Let's declare our faith this morning. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Be seated. Lord, thank You for this comforting, instructing, encouraging, directing, God-saturated, shepherd caring for His sheep, Psalm. You know where we are. We are exactly in whatever situation that we're in by Your sovereign design. You have us where we need to be. Help us to receive Your grace and Your teaching and Your discipline and Your comfort wherever we are in our journey. Speak to us through the preaching of the Word. May Your hand be upon the preacher and all of us as we hear and worship You. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We began looking at the psalm last Lord's Day, just a continuation of our study in John 10 of the shepherd and his sheep. I just felt we couldn't leave that without spending some time at least. And everyone's favorite psalm, perhaps the psalm most known, most quoted, most memorized by both believers and unbelievers alike. A psalm used at the beginning of life, a psalm used in the midst of the valley of despair and temptation, a psalm used on the deathbed, and a psalm used at the graveside. A psalm that is dear and near to Christians throughout history. A psalm that begins with a declaration of faith. The Lord is my shepherd. That's David's proclamation. Right now, present tense, Yahweh, the I Am, the eternal, uncreated, self-sustaining, that God who spoke the worlds into being, that God is my shepherd. Therefore, I shall not want. I shall not want speaks of His provision and care. If Jesus cares for the lilies of the field and the birds of the air, we know that He will care and protect and provide for His people. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want for temporal needs, nor shall I want for eternal needs. The Father and the Son hold me in their hands, and those who seek the Lord, the Scripture says, shall not lack any good thing. My present and my future are in His hands. His care is mine. An old Puritan asked, how can we raise from the fear of want? He said, by committing ourselves to the care of the Good Shepherd. So the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. This is where we were last week. What we shall not want His provision. In verses 2 through 6, He makes me lie down in green pastures. It's been said that sheep are often slow to lie down. They're anxious. They won't lie down if they've been in some sort of disruption with another, one sheep with another. Or if they have fear. Or if they're hungry or anxious in some way. And so the shepherd sometimes has to make the sheep lie down. You know, the sheep, as we've looked at last Lord's Day, are not that intelligent on their own. They're totally dependent on the shepherd's care, or they will be killed. And sometimes the sheep will just stand and keep moving and wander away, and the shepherd has to make the sheep lie down. I wonder how many times, maybe in your life or in lives of people you know, people who would not lie down, who would not stop, who would not rest in God, who would not be nourished up in the green pastures and drink from the still waters that He provided, that God made them lie down for their own good, for their own ultimate well-being. So we shall not want for God's provision. And we looked at the REST with that. Renewal, enablement, God's sustaining grace, and God teaches us. Renewal enables, sustains, and teaches us. God's provision. So these sheep begin like you do at 4 in the morning, very early in the morning, and the shepherd leads them out. He leads them to green pastures and to still waters. We learn from John 10 that He goes before the sheep and He leads the sheep. He's out in front. He's not leading from behind. He's not herding the sheep driving the sheep like a rancher. He's leading the sheep because He is a shepherd. He leads them beside still waters. Again, sheep were afraid to drink from fast flowing water, so He took them to still waters, peaceful, tranquil waters. They wouldn't be swept away. Their coat would not be weighed down, therefore, and so they would be safe and provided for, quiet waters. Perhaps the pastures are the Word of God and the water is the Spirit of God. We need to eat upon the Word of God, but the Spirit must bring the Word to life. The Holy Spirit must open our eyes and enable our hearts and give us illumination that we might understand and see and grasp the Word of God. He restores my soul. He brings the soul back from weariness and from wandering. Two challenges for the sheep. Sheep grow weary under the hot sun. They grow weary from the troubles and trials and difficulties of life. And sometimes the sheep wander away. And so the word restore means to put back together again. Perhaps they're depleted, they're empty, they're spent, they're broken, they have nothing else to give, they have no answers, and so the shepherd comes and he brings soul restoration. He renews them from the depths of their being, in the depths of their being. Like the psalmist in Psalm 119, revive me in accordance with your word. And so God nourishes them, puts them back together, gives them rest, restores their strength. And then if they have wandered away, He loves His children enough to discipline them, to correct them, to bring them under the rod of correction. As the old Puritan said, the same hand which first rescued us from ruin reclaims us from all our subsequent aberrations. And so He calls us to return, and we return, and God restores us. And then we saw that He leads His sheep in the paths of righteousness. The paths of righteousness. And I ask the question, take an honest look at your heart right now. Is your heart inclined towards God or not? Are you on the right path or the wrong path? One of the beautiful things and painful things about this last weekend was the skill in which God used the teachers of His Word to open up our hearts and let us take a look at what was inside. And some of us, we didn't like what we saw. We were discussing when your anger burns, the sinfulness of sinful anger. We also looked at anger redeemed, how anger can be a good thing and properly placed, properly motivated, passionate for God's holiness and His truth. But we were exposed. And I remember writing in my notes, as one of the speakers was speaking, all the things that I'm angry about right now. All the things that I'm angry about. Now, there's a holy anger that we should have against sin and against that which is wrong. But how do we respond? That's the question. That's really a part of the skillful surgeon opening the heart and exposing the sin within. And I found, and I was convicted and burdened as my list grew longer and longer and longer and longer and longer at all the things that I am angry about. And I was led to repent of my sin and ask God's grace and help, and I will need His ongoing grace to help me in days to come. I realized that my heart was not inclined towards God in this way, on the paths of righteousness. And so one of the means that God uses to put His people back on the right path is the preaching of the Word of God. Listen, this is why preaching is so necessary. It may seem like foolishness to the world. For some, it might seem like an utter waste of time. But I can't tell you how many times when under the powerful preaching of God's Word, God has touched my heart, exposed my sin, washed me in His Word, and put me back on the path. I can't say that these last couple of days have been fun. I can say they have been painful. Though there was some fun, there was some laughter, and there was some joy, but for me, it was excruciatingly painful to have my sin exposed. After the first speaker, and then I spoke the second message, I opened up by saying I'm mad at the first speaker, because obviously he's been hacked by the Russians, and he's been wiretapping my phones and looking at my emails and watching my family and watching how I've been responding to folks, and he just told everybody about my anger and my sin. And I was angry. I said, I'm angry at you, brother. But God used that to help me, to put me back and begin me, I pray, on the journey back to, in this way, the paths of righteousness. We have to consider our lives. Every time we come under the preaching of God's Word, every time we read the Word of God, we should be under the looking glass, asking God to expose our hearts. You know, we're not here just to, you know, we're members of the church, check off the membership. Okay, I'm here. All right, what's next? We come into this place as we sing to worship God. We also come into this place to be changed by God, to be changed by God through His Word. And so we have to ask hard questions of ourselves when the Scripture opens us up like the surgeon. We're on the operating table and our heart is opened and we're hooked to the monitors. We have to ask ourselves some question: what path am I on? What sin am I nursing? What sin am I holding on to? And how is my sin cultivating righteousness in my own heart, and how is my sin cultivating righteousness in others? You know what the answer to that is? Your sinful anger, for example, is not producing the righteousness of God in others or yourself. It's not. It can't. See, God uses spiritual means to bring about spiritual results. And you can get angry with your children, sinfully angry with your children. You can yell at them. You can scream at them. You can beat them with a rod. You can force them into obedience, and your sinful anger will not produce the result that you're looking for. Again, a holy anger, yes, but sinful anger, no. And so your sinful anger, your sin of any sort, will not produce the effect that you want. You want a situation changed, your anger, sinful anger, is not going to change that situation. It's not going to produce the righteousness of God. It's going to produce and create other problems, deeper problems. It's going to take more skill then to unravel. And so I say to you, He leads us in the paths of righteousness. And so God will open us up. He will discipline us. He will take us in the valley. He will expose us. And it's a painful process. But God loves us. And He's trying, and He's working to change us. So that with the psalmist, we could stand on level ground. In Psalm 26:12, in the great assembly, and praise God. So look for spiritual means to bring about spiritual results. When it comes to the church, we use the old phrase, the ordinary means of grace. And what that means is we come to on the Lord's day with the Lord's people, and we try to employ the means that God has promised to bless. And so we read the Word, we pray the Word, we sing the Word, and we preach the Word of God, and we participate in His ordinances, the Lord's Supper and baptism. So would you be so honest before God this morning, the shepherd who loves you, the father who leads you to green pastures and still waters, and leads you through the valley of the shadow of death and prepares a table before you, would you be so honest before one who loves you unconditionally, and he will not stop loving you no matter what? Even when you're faithless, the Bible says he remains faithful. There's no good coming from your sin. Why hold on to it? Let it go and turn to our Lord. And so he leads them in the paths of righteousness. The sheep can't see very far. They're nearsighted. They have to be led to safe paths. And if they deviate from the path, they put themselves in danger, and they put others in danger as well. I shall not want protection. He protects me in danger. And that's where we really pick up the new material this week. Verse 4, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Think on that for a second. This is God's protection for his children. And notice what he says. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. So this shadow of death, this valley, and the shepherd leads the sheep out, and especially towards the midsummer and late summer, he's leading them through valleys, leading them up ultimately to higher ground where they will be nourished and cared for until wintertime starts threatening and he brings them back down to their home again. He has to lead them through valleys to get to the high ground. He has to lead them through this valley of the shadow of death. But along the way, the psalmist says, I will fear no evil. Why? Not because he's courageous in himself, not because he's strong and mighty and powerful. Just the opposite. I'll fear no evil because you are with me. So there's confidence that the sheep has in the midst of great danger. Now along the pilgrim's pathway, and you are a sheep, and you are on the pilgrim's pathway, you are going to encounter dangers of every sort. In fact, you have no idea how much danger you're in right now. You know, we seem relatively safe here in this building, right? Things are pretty peaceful, calm. But we have no idea what sort of danger we're in right now. We have no idea what sort of schemings that the wicked one may be about to bring along our pathway to tempt us to leave the right path and enter the wrong path. We know what sort of trials await us that threaten to undo us when the heavy burdens of life are placed upon our shoulders and we are then tempted to abandon God, forsake God, deny God, curse God, and die or fall into the pit of despair. We don't know. There are all sorts of troubles right now all around us. We cannot see. We see some of them, but we don't see the extent of them. We don't know what's just down the road and just around the bend. We do know this, though, we will encounter trouble of every sort, and some of the valleys will be dark, and they will be deep, and they will be death-like. You see, the psalmist here is not, I don't think, at the point of death, but he's going through a death-like experience, and death has cast its cold shadow over the valley through which the psalmist is walking. And he says that I will not fear because you are with me. So this is not our dying moment necessarily, but the valleys that are ahead. And the way to face the valley is to know that just around the bend, God will bring us relief and God will bring us help. But God uses the valley. Now this is the way we tend to think. When we're entering the valley or we're in the midst of the valley, our tendency is to think, if I could just get out of the valley, then I would be okay. Then my life would be well ordered, my joy would be restored, my hope would be renewed, and I would be more godly if I could just get out of this valley. And the opposite is true. You are in that valley because God Himself has placed you in that valley. He has put you there. He knows that you need to be in the valley. In fact, He has led you into the valley. Philip Keller, who's a shepherd himself and wrote a number of books about shepherds and shepherd and sheep, he writes, "The simple fact is that just as water can only flow in a ditch or channel or valley, so in the Christian's career, the life of God can only flow in blessings through the valleys that have been carved and cut into our own lives by excruciating experiences." That's worth thinking about. That's worth chewing on and meditating. Water can only flow in a ditch or channel or valley. So the Christian, his life, the life of God, can only flow in blessings through the valleys that are carved and cut into our lives by excruciating experiences. This is how God makes us and molds us and makes us channels of blessing. Typically, when God is going to do great things through a person, He takes them through dark valleys, where the shadow of death cast its covering, and where fear is all around and trouble surrounds him. But we must remember when we're there that God is carving out in our lives through these experiences channels through which His water of life can flow. God knows where we are. He's not in heaven saying, "How in the world did they get there? What are they doing in the valley of the shadow of death?" No, the Scripture says He led them there. He led them there. And this is what we need to think about as we walk through valleys, as we walk through hard times. Two things, supremacy and sufficiency. I preached from Colossians yesterday, and I hung a lot of the text on those two words, the supremacy of Jesus and the sufficiency of Christ. And so as we think about the valley, we have to remember what life is really all about anyway. And Colossians says that life, we're created, in Colossians 3, we're created by God and for God. We're created by Christ and for Christ. So when things are dark and you're in the valley, remember this, the supremacy, that life is about the supremacy of Jesus Christ. Life is really not about your comfort. Life is really not about your, happiness in that regard, externally speaking, your happiness in Christ. But life is about your life bringing glory to Jesus Christ. God is most passionate for His glory and for us to display His glory. We also need to remember in the valley the miracle of salvation that God has accomplished for us. That He has transferred us out of the kingdom of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son of His love. A great transfer has happened. And so though things are dark all around us, we remember that we have been delivered from God's wrath and from His judgment and from condemnation and from hell from our sins. Though things are hard, we remember what God has accomplished and its long-term effects on us. Though the outward man is decaying, the Scripture says, the inward man is being renewed day by day. So in the valley, the carvings are happening on your forehead. Your body is being beaten and you are being assailed by the high waters of difficulty. But you remember during those times that God has put me there to glorify Him, to honor Him, to work in my life in such a way that I better glorify Him and honor Him. And while there, I remember that though my body they may kill, His truth abideth still. And His truth said, "He who began a good work in me will complete it until the day of Christ." That even if I die in the valley, I wake up in the arms of my Savior because of the miracle of salvation. And so we remember. We remember next to His sovereign control over the universe. Remember Joseph and his brothers, and they're fearful towards the end, there, end of Genesis, I think it's chapter 50. They're fearful that Joseph, now that they've been exposed and he's still alive, is going to bring great judgment upon them. There are going to be great consequences that Joseph is going to bring. And Joseph said, he's not in the place of God. He said, God meant it. You meant it for evil. God meant it for good. God is sovereign over the universe, who hung Jesus to the cross, wicked men, but God ordained that Jesus go to the cross for the salvation of a vast multitude. So God is sovereign over the universe. He was sovereign over Joseph's being sold as a slave, being falsely charged and imprisoned. Joseph's rise in leadership again. He was sovereign over Joseph, sovereign over his brothers, and God intended it for good. God intended the death of Jesus for your good and mine. Though the cross was brutal, horrific, cursed. Cursed is everyone who dies on a tree. If God is sovereign over Joseph, and God is sovereign over the cross of Jesus Christ, God is sovereign over your life and over your circumstances. Nothing can touch you, but it comes through the Father's hand in accordance with the Father's will, designed for the Father's purposes. So you have to remember in the valley what it's all about. It's about the glory of Jesus Christ. It's about remembering the miracle of salvation that He's accomplished. And though, indeed, you draw your last breath in that valley, if that is the case, you remember you'll see Jesus soon. You remember His sovereignty over the universe. You remember that you are where you are by the sovereign power and design of God, exactly where you need to be. And sometimes in the valley you're saying, I am facing an impossible, demanding situation. I have no answers and I have no wisdom. I do not know how to get out of this impossible situation or how to even deal at all with this situation. And so you realize that, and you confess that, and you understand that you're in an impossible situation. In the valley, you may feel lonely and isolated, but you must remember the supremacy of Jesus. His supremacy is seen in your sanctification. In the valley, God is sanctifying you. He is working conformity to Jesus Christ in you, through you, in the valley of the shadow of death. He is making you like Jesus. And the more like Jesus you are, the more Jesus is seen as supreme in your life. So the supremacy of Jesus is cultivated in your sanctification. A big part of your sanctification happens through suffering in the valley. And that sanctification best glorifies God when you realize in the valley God is sanctifying you and you find your satisfaction in Jesus Christ alone. In Him. As Colossians says, in Christ are all the treasures. And so when we have nothing else, sometimes God brings us to a point where we realize we have nothing else to depend on, no resources left to empower us, no wisdom that we might figure out how to get out of this situation. We're reminded that in Jesus are all the treasures. And we find our satisfaction in the valley. Not in our might, not in our power, not in our strength, not in our resources, not in anything here. But we learn to find our satisfaction in Jesus Christ. And when you learn to find your satisfaction in Christ alone, then your life is set to glorify God mightily and wonderfully. You see, the Bible tells us that the sinner is filled with the fruit of his ways. And so you remain in your sin, you resist God's grace and sanctification in that suffering, and you fight against it and accuse God and blame God and get sinfully angry with God and with others because of the situation that you're in. You will be filled with the fruit of your way, and you'll look around you and you'll see that fruit. It will stare you in the eyes, and it will bring you even greater pain. But we submit to the work of God in our hearts during those times. But sometimes it's helpful, I think, to do an examination and just say, where has my sin brought me? What has my sin produced? What kind of fruit has my sin produced in my life and in the life of others? And so we see that, that God loves us enough that he's squeezing, he's pressuring, he's working, he's digging, he's weeding out sin and teaching us how important it is to wake up every day and put sin to death, to seek those things which are above, to set our mind on things above, to sever the deeds of the flesh, to mortify them, to kill them every day, not to give any corner to sin, but to fight with all our might. Sin is our enemy. As Jeremiah Burroughs writes in his treatise, the evil of evils is sin. It's sin. So if a member of ISIS were to be walking up your driveway with weapons in hand, and you're there, what are you going to say? Let's drink a cup of coffee and talk about this. Is that the way you're going to treat ISIS, who wants to kill you, who wants to behead you, who wants to destroy you? No, you put ISIS to death, right? And that's what we do with sin. We don't drink a cup of coffee with sin. We don't laugh at sin. We don't take sin casually. But we put sin to death, because every morning when you wake up, sin is crouching at the door. It's knocking. And so you must wake up putting on the armor of God and prepare to do battle. Go to war. Fight. No time to play dilly-dally and footsie with the enemy. Sin is your enemy, and sin wants to kill you. As Owen said, either you be killing sin or sin will be killing you. So you have to go to war. And you see there that God is working out that sin in the valley. So we've learned what it's all about in the valley. It's about Jesus, His glory. We remember the miracle He's accomplished, the gospel of grace and salvation. We rest in His sovereign choice over our lives. We remember Joseph and Jesus and His sovereignty in all things, His sovereignty over my life. We know then that we're exactly where we are because that's where we need to be in our sanctification, so that we might find our satisfaction in Christ and then better exalt the supremacy of Jesus Christ. We find that he is supreme and he's sufficient. All the treasures are in him. And so sometimes you're looking at an impossible situation and you're saying again, I need to be out of this valley. And the Lord says, no, you need to be in the valley. And you need to be satisfied in the valley with the treasury, the treasures of Christ and His gospel. If I'm not satisfied in His sufficiency in the valley, I will not be satisfied with His sufficiency on the mountaintop. We learn to be satisfied in Jesus when Jesus is all there is. When Jesus is all we have, when Jesus is all that we treasure, we learn to be satisfied in Him. And so, we remember why we're here. We remember the gospel that saved us. We trust in the sovereignty of God. We consider our sin and the fruit it's produced. And we appreciate and thank God for His correction and discipline in the valley to make us more like Jesus. And because Jesus is our treasure, we learn Christ. How little so many believers know about our Savior. How much we know about baseball and weather and politics and world affairs. How little we know about Jesus. How little we know about the lover of our soul. The one who died for us. And so we must learn Christ. We must have the mind of Christ, the heart of Christ, the will of Christ. And so therefore we're on a mission every day, not only to mortify our sin, but we mortify it in part by unpacking Christ. There's a great treasury in your heart. There's a great treasury in God's Word. There's a great treasury in His creation. And so we spend our days unpacking the treasure. How sweet it is and fun it is on Christmas morning around the Christmas tree, and the boxes are wrapped and the children are gathered and everyone's excited. What's behind the wrapper? What's behind door number one? And we have this great treasury in Christ, and we just need to unwrap it. We need to discover it. We need to get into the treasure chest and see all the treasures that God has given. How little we know of Christ. How much we know about everything else. how little time we spend with our Savior. You know, we're just busy. We've got things to do, people to see and places to go, and how little time we spend in the pastures of His Word. How little time we spend knowing that He's sufficient and learning in the valley that He is big and He's big enough. His shoulder, your shoulders aren't. Your back isn't strong enough. But Jesus is enough. He's sufficient. And so here in the valley, His confidence comes, not because He's so strong, but here it is, I'll fear no evil. Why? For you, who's you? Yahweh, the eternal creator, uncreated, self-sustaining, almighty, eternal, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, God is with me. So then, in the New Testament we hear, if God be for you, who can be against you? Why fear our enemies when Almighty God is with us? God goes with us. God is by His Spirit in us. And like the Good Shepherd, He goes before us. You've probably been in a lot of unsettling, unnerving situations. And one of the unnerving things about death is that though we know what the Bible says, there are many uncertainties about death. I mean, what is it going to be like when it comes that time? What is it going to be like? How am I going to feel? Am I going to be suffering? Am I going to be panicked? What's it like? I mean, we know what the Scripture says, but you know, when we get into that last river and we no longer can see the celestial city, perhaps things are so dark and clouded. When Pilgrim was fighting the devil in the valley of the shadow of death, in the daytime he could wield his sword and he could fight, but when the night fell and the darkness fell and he couldn't see, it was unnerving. And darkness is like that, isn't it? I've had grown strong men tell me, you know what? They say, I don't like being alone in the dark. You know, maybe we never outgrow that because there's uncertainty in the dark. Things sound differently, look differently, what we can see. Well, you've been there, and if you've ever been alone in a scary situation in the dark, perhaps fear has gripped your heart. You've probably been in a lot of unsettling situations. I have, many times directly connected to pastoral ministry over my life. Years ago in a church, I had to walk into a situation all alone with a very strong personality. I'll never forget getting my car and driving over to the meeting spot to meet this very intimidating older man who was arrogant and dismissive and looked and despised my youth, if you will. So I drove up and I walked to the table and there he was. And I had to confront him over numerous sins. And I was doing everything I could to keep my knees from knocking. I was a young pastor and I was all alone. And I was scared. I was just trying not to show him that I was scared. Because I had about 10 points. 10-point sermon. 10 issues I had to address him with. And I remember later after that having to call him up on the phone before a major confrontation was about to unfold and say, I'm going to ask you again before this happens to repent. And again, I can still remember the night, still remember going to the phone, still remember dialing his number, still remember him answering the phone and trying to hide and cover the trembling voice on my end. Because he was not humble. He was not willing to receive anything I said or anybody else said for that matter. However, I can think in your life as well, times you've had to walk into difficult situations and you had someone with you. What a difference that made. I remember years ago at a church I was serving, We had someone call me, and they said they were demon-possessed. And they wanted us to come, wanted me to come. I said, okay, hang on there just a second. So let me check on something here. Get on the other line, call a guy, and say, are you busy right now? I wasn't interested in walking into that house with this person that they thought was demon-possessed. And so this guy said, I can go. And so we drove. And I, even in that case, even with that guy by my side, I was a little nervous about what we were about to encounter. Now, we went in there, and we didn't see any specific evidence of that, but we preached the gospel, we prayed with the person, but I was better because I had someone with me. That's been true in every bad situation in my life. When I've gone into difficult situations with Lori, even one of the children with me, it's been calming to me. It's been calming when Kevin and I've had to go into difficult situations and address challenging situations, to go together and not alone. Perhaps Solomon was right, right? He was. Two are better than one. And a threefold cord is not easily broken. We need one another. We need the unity and the commitment and the love for each other. But listen, even if we didn't have that, this we can remember. When we are in the valley of the shadow of death and our enemies are firing down upon us from the high ground above, we have God with us. You, Yahweh, Almighty God, you are with me. So the next time you have to walk into such a situation, why don't you just remember and meditate and repeat that over and over and over. You are with me. Notice how personal he is again. For you are with me. You're with me. No more comforting words. When the cold wind of death or trouble blows in the believer's face and the dark clouds connect with the light and a shadow is cast. By the way, remember there must be a light for there to be a shadow, right? Remember that Christ will not leave us in the lurch. He will not. Just like a little sheep is afraid to be alone, he needs to be with the community. He needs to be near the shepherd. And the good shepherd will not leave him alone. And some of the sheep need special care, and the shepherd will take his staff, and he'll reach into the distance and touch that sheep a little bit just to remind him he's there. Just to remind him he's carrying him. He's with him. And he will not leave him in the lurch. The psalmist says, call on the Lord in the day of trouble, and he will deliver you. No fear. James Janaway, the Puritan preacher, it was said of him that he could as easily die as shut his eyes. Such calmness pervaded his soul. Beecher said of the 23rd Psalm, it is the nightingale of the Psalms. The nightingale sings its sweetest when the night is darkest. A few years ago, I don't know what these birds were. I don't remember. I think I knew then. But we went through several months, I think about 3 months, of birds that were singing it all night. They were not out there in the daytime. Outside of our bedroom window, these birds sang all night. Have you been around those birds before? And maybe it was a nightingale. I don't know my birds, but a Spurgeon would be disappointed. He knew every bird. But they would sing outside of our window every night. The darker it got, the louder they sang. Well, though I didn't always appreciate that at the moment, the Psalm 23 sings in the dark midnights. When Paul and Silas were imprisoned, and it was midnight, and shackles having been beaten, they sang. It was a dark time. It was a damp prison cell. Their body was aching with pain. And they sang. Thankfully, these sheep had been to pastures and still waters and put back on the right path so they could face this bitter storm with faith. And then he says he comforts with his rod and staff. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The real comfort is knowing that there's one who's holding the rod and staff, that God is with us when the sands of time are sinking,
or we're in high weeds and deep waters, it's the most comforting of all that God is holding the rod, God is holding the staff. And what does He do with the rod? One of the purposes of the rod is to count the sheep. And so the sheep would pass under the rod, so to speak. It would pass under the rod and they'd be counted. And so when we're going through hard times, God uses His rod to remind us that we are counted as His elect. We are His servants that He loves. The rod is used to protect the sheep. And so the shepherd was very skilled. He could take that rod, he could throw it at a wild animal, pierce him, knock him out of the way, run him off, bang him over the head. It was used to correct the sheep. So gently he might use the rod of correction to keep the sheep from danger and on the right path. The Lord keeps count of us. He keeps our tears in a bottle. He knows the hairs on our head. He corrects us. He uses the rod to press us on. Sometimes the sheep get a little lazy, and they don't really want to do anything. And so the shepherd prods them, moves them forward with his rod. Again, they're pretty defenseless animals. And so this hard club, this 3-foot-long club David used to kill a lion with, and protecting his sheep. It's 1 Samuel 17. The staff, on the other hand, is 8 feet long, and it has a crook in it. So a sheep could, kind of wander away, and the shepherd could take the crook in the staff and grab around the leg of one of the sheep and just pull him back over. Or if he slipped down a ledge and maybe he was hanging on a bush or a rock or something below, the shepherd could take this long staff, wrap it around his belly, and pull him up to safety. And when a little lamb was born, maybe it had become separated from its mother for some reason, instead of the shepherd going to pick up the little lamb, which might cause the mother to reject it, the shepherd would take the staff and scoop up the little lamb and bring it over to the mother. Such is the care of the shepherd. The shepherd is equipped for every emergency. There are no emergencies with the Good Shepherd. He's prepared. He's equipped. And then it says that we shall not be wanting for a table in the midst of our troubles. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. From death's shadow to God's banquet. What a picture. You prepare a table before me where? Behind the walls of safety when we have no enemies and everything's going well. No, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now, he could be talking about one or two things, because in a moment he's going to talk about the house of the Lord forever. Maybe the scene is now shifting and it's the picture of an indoors and there's a big table set and there's plenty of food and there's all the provision that they'll need. There's a sense of safety in the home. Or he may be talking about the table of the mountains. And so the shepherd, before he would take these sheep up to the mountaintop, through the valley up to the mountaintop, he would go before them and check out sometime, some weeks before he was to lead them up there, he would go ahead and check things out. And he would look for poisonous plants. He would make sure the pathway was straight. He would just prepare the way for them, so that as they go through the valley, head back up the mountain, enemies are surrounded them, their provision is there. There's a table prepared for them. In Palestine, there were poisonous plants everywhere, and they could kill the sheep. Thorny plants could hurt the sheep. The shepherd made the way ready by going ahead. Now look where this table is. It is in the presence of his enemies. So this is a picture. The battle is raging, and yet God's sheep can sit peacefully around the table and eat. He can eat his bread with peace in his heart, though trouble is raging all around him. The same is true of sleep. The sheep who really understands the shepherd and understands the shepherd's psalm, and who trusts the shepherd's sovereignty and understands the shepherd's purposes and knows the shepherd's care and love, can sit down and enjoy a meal, though the enemies are banging on the doors, threatening to kill him. He can put his head to pillow at night, though a storm is raging outside, and trust that God will care for him. Do you eat your bread with peace like that? Do you take your sleep in the evening with peace like that? If not, why don't you spend 30 days meditating on Psalm 23? Memorizing it, repeating it, thinking about it, considering it, pondering it deep in your heart, and learning to apply it. Then quickly he says, "You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over." So this is a picture, perfume on the head and wine running down the cup. This is being anointed by God's Spirit. It's said that visitors in the East were often anointed with perfume and were poured choice wine until it ran out of the glass. What does that say? There's no lack here. There's abundance of wine in the winery. There's abundance of provision at God's house. And so it overfills. He anoints. The perfume is poured out. What sweet blessings God pours on His suffering saints in the valley of the shadow of death. What a bountiful feast God prepares for His hungry children who are weary in the midst of the storm, if we will but eat it. You know, a haphazard approach to church is a neglect of your spiritual health. And a neglect of the very means that God has designed to feed you. A haphazard approach to your church will undermine your spiritual confidence and your spiritual health. Because this is the table that God has provided for us on the banquet day of the soul, the first day of the week, to come to the table of the Lord and to eat of Him each week, the bread of life, and then today, to come to the Lord's table and eat. Perfume on the head, wine running over the cup, love, respect, abundance. An old writer notes, great refreshment in being anointed with oil, smoothness to touch, bright to sight, fragrant to smell, a delightful experience. And oftentimes people who were relieved of pain, were anointed with oil, and it was massaged into their body. That's probably what's happening in James when it says, you know, if you're sick, call for the elders of the church, let them, you know, anoint you with oil and pray over you. It's probably more than dropping some, you know, olive oil on the head. It's probably a believer who is bruised in the battle, and literally the elders are massaging him back to health. It's more than just a drop of oil on the head and a quick prayer. It's massaging God's word and prayer and love into the heart of this broken down, sick believer and asking God to raise him up. Have you ever just been down on your back and having pain all over your body and had the privilege of going to and get a massage? How wonderful, right? And you know, when it's over, you say, really? It's already over? Could I purchase another hour? Do you do 6-hour massages? So you guys can go see Brandy. She's our masseuse here in the church. Maybe she does a 6-hour massage. Get you well again. And so if you go, I get a percentage of that for announcing it from the pulpit. Okay, just a side thought there. But that's what's happening here. It's massaging the oil of God's Spirit, His Word, His care, His ministry, His love into the body of the hurting, poor, struggling saint who's been through everything. And like Spurgeon said, though, that word through is a word of hope. Through the valley indicates that I'm going to come through the valley and get to the other side. And so either you're going to get to the other side through the ministry of the Word, the care of the shepherd, and using His saints to massage you back to health and to give you the wine that Psalm 104 says brings joy to the heart, the oil like brightens the face. Wine rejoices the heart. It has a physical effect on believers. So you're going to get through that valley through the ministry of God's Word, the ministry of God's Spirit, the ministry of God's people, and you're going to get to the other side and live on and be able to glorify God longer. Or you're going to get through the valley and realize that there's some gates open for you on the other side. A young man asked me last week, he said, do you really think there are golden gates there? And do you really think there's going to be someone to greet us there? I said, I don't have any reason to not believe there's going to be golden gates. They're going to be wide open. And not just someone to greet us, but like Fanny Crosby sang in her great hymn, my Savior, first of all. My Savior, first of all. So he perfumes the head. He rubs it in. What a head massage. You ever stayed awake through that? I've got an old barber I go to when I'm in Louisville, and she will say, "Do you want, you know, you want the head massage now?" So yes, ma'am. And it's all you can do to just stay awake while that's going on. The massage, the wine, the abundance. God's blessings are not given sparingly. God pours out His love. We need to be more like God. I think sometimes we're so stingy with our resources. What if we just stopped being stingy and started just giving and pouring out and loving? Being agents of healing in times of difficulty. Psalm 147, 3 through 4 says, He heals the broken heart. He tells the number of the stars. Listen, your pain matters. You know, there are many people say, you know, just suck it up. Don't worry about it. Get through it. Come on, man. What's the problem? The Lord cares about your broken heart. He wants you to bring, as the psalmist said in one of our readings from this morning, He wants us to bring our cries and our groanings to Him early in the morning because He can heal us. So we're not content to remain in the pits of despair, nursing our brokenness, but we cry out to God to help us, to heal us, to strengthen us, to renew us, to send us onward. Then he says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Now this is the picture. This is not the picture that you're up ahead of surely, you're up ahead of goodness and mercy, and you keep looking back. Hurry up, guys. The picture is more like this. You've been caught speeding in Dawsonville, and you're trying to outrun the law. And the law is coming after you. The law is in pursuit of you. That's more the picture. It's not the goodness and mercy. I keep wanting to give Shirley one of those things. Shirley's coming too. Here comes Shirley. So if your wife's named Shirley, look back. Here she comes. Surely, goodness and mercy will pursue you. It's not lagging behind. It's coming after you. God is the great hound of heaven. He comes after His people in hot pursuit. What a picture of God's beauty and love and mercy and kindness. He is running after us with blessings abundant, not necessarily health and wealth, but better blessings. That's how God loves His sheep. You think if a sheep goes astray that God is going to be content to say, well, I've got 99. Not going to worry about the one. That's not our God. God will come after you. And as we walk with Him and trust Him, after us with great blessings. And finally, I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God, I shall not want for future provision. I shall not want for eternal life. I shall, future grace stirs up present grace. I shall dwell in God's house forever with a life that can never be snatched from me. Therefore, I keep following the shepherd in this life. future grace motivates me to pursue Christ passionately now. So what do you need to do? Declare your faith in God as your shepherd. Receive His gifts gladly. It's folly to imagine that you don't need God's provision of rest, peace, restoration, leadership, protection, and care. Make it your aim to follow Christ. His sheep follow Him. They hear His voice, they follow Him. And fear not. When you're in the valley, remember His sovereignty. Remember the ultimate purpose of life. Remember your salvation. Remember that God is showing you that Jesus is all that you need. And fear not. Though this world with devils filled shall threaten to undo us, I will not fear, for God is with us. God is with me. Face the future with faith. On Sunday evening, April 4th, 1886, Charles Spurgeon looked up from his pulpit. He looked into the eyes of his vast congregation, about 6,000 people, and he confessed the darkness of his heart to them. This wasn't the first time. This would not be the last time. But he openly shared his struggle with God's saints about his soul darkness. But he didn't speak with an air of defeatism about his situation. Nor did he imagine that he was resigned to a life of unhappiness. He looked to Christ, sought the help of God's Spirit, and resolved to fight with God-ordained weaponry. And he wrote, and he said, "What a help it is to a Christian man to be glad in the Lord. I know what it is to be depressed. I do not suppose there is any person in this place who knows what it is to be cast down so low as I am sometimes. Then I feel that there is no help for me and no hope of living and working except I can get out of that sad situation and get glad in the Lord. And I cry, 'My heart, what art thou? Why art thou cast down, O my soul? And why art thou disquieted within me? Hope in God. I shall yet praise Him, who is the health of my countenance and my God. There's no way of getting right out of the bog of the slough of despond like rejoicing in the Lord. If you try to rejoice in yourself, you will have very poor reason for joy. But if you rejoice and be glad in the Lord, you who have the real abiding and changing source of joy, for he who rejoices in Christ rejoices in Him who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he may always rejoice in Him. Come then, and for your own good, hang up the sackcloth. Take down the psaltery." Good word for Lent here. "Put away the ashes. What if men do call this season Lent? We will keep no Lent tonight. This is our Eastertide. Our Lord has risen from the dead, and He is among us, and we will rejoice in Him." Not only is He among us, He is in us by His Spirit. He is with us. Spurgeon knew what it was to be in the valley of the shadow of death. He imagined that few people perhaps had suffered the depth of darkness as he did. He was not immune from the trials of life. Sometimes he felt hopeless and despaired of life itself. And yet he kept rejoicing. He kept fighting. He didn't swim around in self-pity. He purposely remembered his God, and he cried out by praying Psalm 42 and 43. This is how the Psalms can come to your aid when you're struggling and suffering and in the dark valley. You just pray them back to God. "Why are you downcast, O my soul? Hope in the Lord." You remember His sovereignty, remember His sanctifying purposes, remember His satisfying grace. And so, he applied God's Word. He wasn't content to stay where he was, but to march on following the shepherd through the dark valley, looking for better days, trusting God in the dark times, and continuing to rejoice in God. He recognized that essential to getting out of the slough of despond was rejoicing. He didn't feel like rejoicing, but he did it anyway. He went against his emotions to rejoice in Christ. And we're Christians. We're not to allow our feelings to rule over us as a hard master. We must rise up against our feelings and rejoice when they say not to. Again, that doesn't mean slap happy, everything's okay. It means that we remember God is with us in the valley. And so he encouraged his congregation to put away the ashes of Lent. By the way, the ashes on your forehead will not change your heart. It is your heart that needs changing. Put away the ashes of Lent. Take up the Psalms. Remember that Jesus is risen. And rejoice. His name is engraven on your heart, so how can you forget him? Remember his love, for if surely there's anything we ought to remember, it is that undying love which is our choicest portion and will be our highest joy in heaven. Take up your Bible and read. Remember Jesus Christ risen from the dead. Remember the love of Christ. What wondrous love is this? Oh, he said, let us have Christ's love in the cup, the love that we may daily drink, the love that we may personally drink. Now at this moment, the love which will be our own, as if there were no others in the world, and yet a love in which 10,000 times 10,000 have an equal share with ourselves. Humbly, prayerfully, purposely, seek to know God and his love for you through Jesus our Savior. Are you a Christian? Jesus loves you. He loves you. He loves you. No one can separate you from your Savior. Drink deeply from the love of Christ. Spurgeon often felt the cold rain of depression saturating his weary heart with greater sorrow. Yet he skillfully wielded deliberate rejoicing and remembering as God as weapons in his fight against heart sadness. We follow our shepherd. We don't raise the white flag of surrender to our enemies. We submit to our Savior. And we follow him. We remember his sovereignty. We find our satisfaction in Jesus. And we're better able to promote his supremacy through sanctification. And we do all of that by looking to a shepherd who laid his life down. Because he loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Come to him. Father, among us this morning may be those who do not know such a shepherd. I pray that they have seen in your word this morning a shepherd that they would want to know, who is willing right now to forgive them of all of their sins, declare them to be in a right standing with himself by his grace through repenting of their sin and believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. But I know this morning I'm talking to some broken-hearted people who have grown weary in the battle and wonder indeed if there is a light at the end of the valley, at the end of the tunnel that they're in. Lord, would you sing this psalm to their hearts and lift their spirits this morning in remembrance that Almighty Creator God, that you, O Lord, are with them and you will not forsake them. And you will take them through that valley and either bring them to the other side for longer years upon this earth in which they might rejoice and glorify you here under the sun. Or you will take them through the very gates of the celestial city where there awaiting is your dear Son whom you love and you sent, with his arms open wide to receive his little lambs into his arms of love and give them what they've always needed, full conformity to the Savior that has loved them. Give us hope this morning through the Shepherd's Psalm, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.